Now, let's move on to the third part, the Bellman equation. First, we discuss how to derive the Bellman equation. We've already defined state value and demonstrated through examples why it's important. While state value is important, how to calculate it? The answer lies in the Bellman equation, which describes the relationship among the values of all states. Next, we derive the Bellman equation. I need to remind you that although this part may seem mathematical, it's not as challenging as it might appear. I encourage everyone to be a little patient. Moreover, through motivating examples, we already have the intuition that will help us understand the mathematics. First, starting from ST and taking action AT leads to this specific trajectory. We can calculate its discounted return, GT, a concept we have already discussed. What's new here? We divide GT into two parts. Extracting the discount factor gamma and reorganizing the part inside the parentheses leads to GT plus 1. Therefore, the return obtained at time t equals the immediate reward, plus the return that will be obtained starting from the next moment, starting from there, adjusted by the discount rate. This is the definition of state value that we introduced. We divide GT into two parts, immediate and future rewards. Because the addition inside the expectation can be separated, we thus obtain two expectations. Next, we analyze these two expectations separately to calculate the two terms. By doing this, we can derive the Bellman equation. Let's examine the first expectation. What is it? At the current moment, I am in state S and the immediate reward is RT plus 1. What is its mean? The mean is represented by this equation. Initially in state S, I have several actions I can take. If I take action A, its probability is determined by pi. When I take action A, the value I get is given here. This represents the probability of receiving R reward upon taking action A from S, and the value of R itself is this. According to the definition of expectation, this leads to the first term. What is the interpretation of this term? It is quite simple. The expectation of the immediate rewards that I can obtain. Now, let's look at the second term. This represents the expectation of the return I get from the next moment, starting from the current state S. This is interesting. It represents the various choices I have from the current S, where I can jump to different S prime. This is the probability of jumping to different S prime, and this is the value obtained from jumping to S prime. Summing them up equals this expectation. Let's examine the interpretation of the first value. My current state is S, my next state is S prime, and I'm calculating the mean of the return obtained from starting at the next state. There's an interesting point. Because once I know the next state is S prime, I do not need to care about what the previous state was. Therefore, this conditional expectation equals this conditional expectation. This is due to the Markov property, or the memoryless property. Moving on from this, what is this? Starting from the next state S prime, we're calculating the average return thereafter. This is essentially a state value, but it's for state S prime. This brings us to the next step in our derivation. Yet, we haven't calculated the probability of moving from S to S prime. What is it? Starting from S, I can choose different actions. This is the probability of choosing this action. This is the probability of transitioning to S prime upon choosing this action. Therefore, this sum equals the probability of transitioning from S to S prime. In this part, we used many basics from probability theory. For those who are not familiar with probability theory, I recommend reading the appendix of my book. In summary, how to interpret the second term? It is the expectation of future rewards. When calculating the second step, we can remove this due to the memoryless Markov property. Now, we present the expression for the Bellman equation. Starting from here, we have two expectations, which we have already calculated. We place their expressions here, and then we get another expression by extracting a term from these two, resulting in the subsequent expression. Do not be intimidated by this equation. It is actually quite straightforward, and we will explain it with examples later. There are some important points to clarify. First, the above equation is called the Bellman equation, which essentially describes the relationship among the state values of different states. How so? The left-hand side is the state value of S, while the right-hand side involves the state value of S prime, thus expressing their relationship through this equation. Additionally, the equation consists of two terms. The first is the immediate reward, and the second is the future reward. It's crucial to understand that this is not a single equation, but a set of equations that hold for all states in the state space. If we haven't states, we will have such equations. By solving these equations together, we can determine the state values. It's important to know that the Bellman equation is not just this single equation. Furthermore, these two are the state values to be calculated. But how to calculate? Bootstrapping. Intuitively, it may seem challenging to compute this state value since it relies on the state values of others, but in fact, we have a set of such equations that, when combined, can be solved. This equation relies on various probabilities, such as this, this, and this. This is policy probability, making the Bellman equation rely on the policy. If we manage to calculate the state value, we are essentially performing policy evaluation, evaluating whether a policy is good or bad. The other two probabilities represent the dynamic model of the system. There are two possible scenarios. The first scenario is that we know the model. In this and the following lectures, we assume that we know the model and will introduce algorithms based on this assumption. If we do not know the model, we can still calculate the state value, but this falls into the category of model-free reinforcement learning, which will be introduced in future lectures. Now, let's explain the Bellman equation through an example. Although the Bellman equation may seem intimidating at first, it is actually quite simple. Consider an example with a policy pi, represented by green arrows. Our task is to write out the Bellman equation. First, let's consider the state value of S1. To establish the Bellman equation for S1, we need to determine the values of these terms. At S1, the probability of taking action A3 is 1, and the probability of taking any action other than A3 is 0. This simplifies this term significantly because it essentially becomes 1, eliminating the need for the summation since all other probabilities are 0. Let's look at this term. Starting from S1, I take action A3. The probability of receiving R equal to 0 is 1, and the probability of receiving R not equal to 0 is 0. Therefore, I will definitely receive R equal to 0. Then, when R equals 0, its probability is 1, so this term is actually 0. Moving on, starting from S1, I take action A3. The probability of jumping to S3 is 1, and the probability of not jumping to S3 is 0. Thus, this term is eliminated, and I know that the transition will be to S3. Therefore, this term is 1, and then this is S3. After the above, we know what the Bellman equation is. It is this. This is after we have determined the specific expressions for all these terms. Some readers might have noticed that we already encountered a similar equation in the previous motivating example. In fact, we can also directly write out a similar equation without referring to the complex expression. For instance, looking at the diagram, what is the state value V pi S1? Starting from here, I will jump to here, and in this process, I will receive an immediate reward of 0 plus gamma times V pi S3, because I will jump to S3. This equation is exactly the same as this one. Although we derive this equation from a more complex expression, it is intuitively very easy to understand. We wrote out the state value for S1 just now. Similarly, we can write out the state values for S2, S3, and S4, thereby forming a system of equations. How exactly to obtain these equations? It is a good exercise, which I'll leave for you to try on your own. After establishing this system of equations, how do we solve these state values? It's quite straightforward and can be done using various methods. I'll skip directly to the outcome, which is as follows. If we set gamma to 0.9 or any other value you prefer, we can obtain specific values that are quite interesting. Remember, we have states S1, S2, S3, and S4. The values of S4, S3, and S2 are all 10, meaning their state values are all 10, while only S1 has a state value of 9. I mentioned earlier that state value represents its worth. A high-value state indicates a location worth moving towards. Why do S2, S3, and S4 have higher values? Because they are closer to the target area compared to S1. Once we've calculated state values, what's the next step? The next step is to improve the policy. Eventually, we can obtain the optimal policy, which we will introduce in the future. Let's move on to another example, which is slightly more complex than the previous one, because it involves two possible directions. Using a method similar to the previous one, we can apply the general expression of the Bellman equation to this example. However, for this simple example, we can also directly write it out manually. Let's start with S1. What does V pi S1 equal? It involves two probabilities. A 0.5 probability of moving right, which incurs a negative 1 immediate reward plus gamma times the state value of S2, and a 0.5 probability of moving down, with an immediate reward of 0, and jumping to V pi S3. Adding these two gives us the Bellman equation for the first state. Similarly, we can write out equations for S2, S3, and S4. We can solve this system of equations and then substitute a specific value for gamma. This gives us the state values. Note that the state values of S4, S3, and S2 remain the same as before, all equal to 10. However, under this policy, the state value of S1 is 8.5, which is lower than 9 in the previous policy. This indicates this policy is not as good as the previous one.